This episode of Techzilla is brought to you by Citrix ShareFile.
NVIDIA dropped a couple of bombs on the discrete GPU market last week. The NVIDIA GeForce GTX 970 and 980. We know you've got questions about the new GPUs, not to mention X99, DDR4, and more. And we've got our favorite PC parts expert in today, Mr. Ryan Trapp, PCPro.com. How you doing, man?
I'm doing pretty good. It was a busy week last week, trying to prepare for all those launches and everything. But now it continues on. Other things will distract us.
It's funny how they just keep releasing new parts.
Well, it's good news.
Yeah, it's a very good news, because as new parts come out, the older parts, which looked pretty fast, are now cheaper, which is a good thing. So 980, not a Titan, and actually a relatively affordable GPU.
I mean, the 980 is $550 is kind of the MSRP you have there. I would never call it affordable.
Okay.
But I would say it is it's a fairly good decrease in cost for the performance that you're getting. Right.
Okay.
So it is competitive in those areas. They were aggressive there. They were more aggressive with the GTX 970 mm-hmm. and its pricing and everything and how it compares to everything else in the market.
GTX 970 selling for about $350. What does that compare to performance wise?
The GTX 970 really goes up against the R9 290 mm-hmm. and maybe the GTX 780 from NVIDIA's own stack. And it wins almost all of those tests in our benchmarking, right? So it's faster than the R9 290, which is about a $50 to $70 more expensive GPU as they stand today. So the GTX 970 was a pretty big, I think, attempt by NVIDIA to really hurt AMD in that field by releasing a higher performance part that runs at significantly lower power and at a significantly lower price.
So it's funny, there's like, I think, 2048 CUDA cores in the 970?
980.
980, my apologies. But that's like, I mean, you're talking about something that would be fantastic for video editing and processing, not just for gaming.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, the Maxwell GPU that they have in both of these parts, right? Mm-hmm. The 970 has, I think, 1664 CUDA cores in it, and the 980 has 2048. But what they were able to do with Maxwell was kind of impressive in that it's still built on the same 28 nanometer process technology. They were able to get the clock speeds up significantly higher. The base clock on the 980 is over 1100 megahertz. Mm-hmm. And in my overclocking with it, I was able to get it almost to 1500 megahertz. Like, it was like 1490. And they were able to do that on the same process tech while lowering power consumption. So, you know, like the GTX 980 is a little bit faster than the GTX 780 Ti and a little bit faster than the Radeon R9 290X. Mm-hmm. So its performance isn't wildly, you know, more impressive than something we have seen before, but it does it with, you know, using 100 to 130 watts less power at the same time.
That's a light bulb running in your house.
Yeah, and we consider the TDP of the GTX 980 is 165 mm-hmm. watts. You're talking about kind of almost being able to run two of those Maxwell GPUs for the same power that you could draw one of those Hawaii GPUs.
So thumbs up for both these cards?
Yeah, I really do think NVIDIA did a good job on both of these releases. The 980 is a great performing card, and again, super low power draw there. The 970 is the one that I think most people are going to be interested in, most willing to purchase. We have another test coming up where we have two 970s running in SLI. You can get that for like $650 to $680, mm-hmm. and how that compares to a single 980 or even something like the $1,000 Radeon R9 295X2. Right, and I think you'll find that the 2970s actually perform better than all of those configurations if you're willing to go in the multi-GPU route.
And my GTX 760 feels just that much slower. Hey, we got a question from one of our viewers, Michael, who's got a question. He's looking at X99 motherboards, and he's looking at, quote, the expensive 8-core i7-5960X Haswell E CPU, and it only has a base clock speed of 3 gigahertz. Question, as progression of more advanced CPUs occurs, it seems that generally base clock speeds have remained fairly close, with Devil's Canyon being fastest. Why does the most advanced CPU have the slowest instead of the fastest clock speed? And Michael sent us a list going from, like, you know, the Core i7-3770K Ivy Bridge at 3.5 gigahertz, Devil's Canyon at 4 gigahertz, Gulftown Westmere at 3.46, the Sandy Bridge E at 3.6, then all the way down to the Haswell E, a quote, measly 3 gigahertz.
you know, for an outside observer that doesn't understand why it's like that, I can mm-hmm. see how you would be confused. And this is, you know, one of the reasons why many, many years ago they stopped kind of advertising clock speed as one of the major, you know, proponents of, or, you know, they stopped advertising clock speed as a way of measuring performance, right? Because the issue that he is forgetting at is that Haswell E processor that's only running at 3 gigahertz base clock has 8 cores. Instead of the 4 cores that Devil's Canyon has. So even though Devil's Canyon is a 4 gigahertz base clock versus a 3 gigahertz base clock, you know, compare that performance or that delta there versus going from 4 cores to 8 cores. And then keep in mind that all this has to be run into a fairly reasonably sized socket, a fairly reasonably sized die. You want to be able to use most of the same types of coolers to cool both of those processors. And so that kind of explains why, as just because, you know, you're increasing the core count, you usually have to suffer in something else, right? So you bring down that clock speed a little bit. They're able to maintain that 140 watt TDP of Haswell E. And also, you know, you've got DDR4 in there as well. So, you know, what you should look at is if he wants to compare the first generation of Haswell versus the refresh of Haswell versus Devil's Canyon, which is still just Haswell, that you can see some of the progression of clock speed. When you start going into different architectures, there's so much that can differ between CPU architecture to architecture, mm-hmm. right, that those comparisons don't make a whole lot of sense.
So basically, don't get hung up on megahertz.
Yeah, no, look at the performance and the applications that you are worried about. That's what you should care about.
So as Michael S. from Kansas City is shopping for his X99, we should probably point out he's going to have a heart attack over the, or at least I keep trying to have a heart attack over the price of DDR4 memory. Is it offering that much more performance over DDR3? I know in theory it's got a huge amount of bandwidth by comparison.
Yeah, I mean, most primary processor memory systems are kind of like that. In theory, mm-hmm. they offer better performance. In reality, there are not that many applications that see the immediate benefits of moving from something like DDR3 to DDR4. Mm-hmm. Most applications are just not memory bandwidth bound. There will be some, especially when you get into high-performance computing or workstation-based computing, that you'll see advantages there. But it also comes with a little bit higher latency.
Right.
On DDR4 compared to DDR3, so you know that is a trade-off as well. In my vision, it's not a reason to not buy X99, but it's not a reason necessarily to buy X99 platforms either. It's just a result of moving to X99.
I just keep looking at the price of DDR4 memory and having a heart attack and flashing back to like 1995. What? How much?
It'll get better. It'll get better, right? You know, as these fabs start to increase their production, right? They're kind of waiting to see how popular DDR4 is, how soon it will be popular on consumer side and the server side. That'll determine how many ICs they're producing, and eventually we'll see that point sometime in the future, maybe not for another year or so, where DDR4 memory kind of crosses paths with DDR3.
I just want to thank each and every early adopter for helping to push that price down.
That's what we do.
Oh, my goodness. If you have a second for one more question, at Dwight Meeks tweeted, at Patrick Norton, you need to warn people about the evil no upgrade desktop PCs out there if the processor is soldered to the motherboard / junk. I'm not sure I agree with this, because what, like 90% of the people who buy PCs never upgrade their CPUs or their memory or their GPUs? Are you feeling pain about this? I know we've talked about it on This Week in Computer Hardware a couple times.
You know, it is a trend that I don't like to see, mm-hmm. right? Because I am a big proponent of upgrading systems and having that upgrade option.
Right.
But more and more systems, especially if you start looking at computers like all-in-one PCs, they're basically taking laptop hardware and moving them into a desktop form factor or some kind of form factor that way. And it does limit your upgradability, but it doesn't, I mean, you're right. Like, the majority of people that are buying off-the-shelf PCs are not interested in getting inside that case and changing things around, right? If they do, maybe you add a graphics card, or maybe you upgrade your storage to an SSD or to a larger capacity hard drive. I would think for most people, by the time you think you need a newer processor is about the time that something else has changed, and it's about time to buy a new all-in-one or a new low-cost desktop. If you're spending more than $500 on a desktop form factor PC, like not an all-in-one, chances are it's going to be built out of standard off-the-shelf components or close to it, and it will be upgradable. If you get into those super ultra low costs, the small form factor machines or the all-in-ones, That's when you get into the world of soldered on processors.
Hey, what's coming up on PC Per, man? I know you're benchmarking madly in the background. I can practically hear the fans howling.
It's almost as if you could. this week, we are going to have a review of the new Acer 4K G-Sync panel. I think it's the XB280HK is the model number. We'll have a review of that up, trying to compare and contrast it to the smaller 25x14 G-Sync panel that has a higher refresh rate, and kind of see which one we would prefer in different circumstances. And we also have, like we talked about before, the GTX 970 SLI benchmark, because I think that at that price point at a $329 MSRP is going to be a product that is ripe for attention for multi-GPU enthusiasts.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to find out what Ryan finds about those two new, I bet, gorgeous monitors, you can go to PCPer.com and read the reviews. It is good stuff. The man knows his testing, and the whole crew there is really, really good. Ryan, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, more Techzilla coming right up. But before we do that, let's take a moment to thank one of our sponsors.
The constant flow of information is crucial to business. You have contracts, spreadsheets, invoices, and other important business files that are sent as regular email attachments with no reliable means to ensure that they've been received or reviewed. You lose control the moment that you hit send. That's why you need Citrix's ShareFile. It's the easy-to-use business solution for sending, receiving, and sharing files. With ShareFile, your attachments are sent as secure links. You can send links of almost any size without bounce backs, and they're always under your control. So you decide who has access to your files and for how long. You receive notifications telling you who opens your files and when. Plus, you can password protect files for optimal security. Then you can easily share files and collaborate with others. And ShareFile mobile apps allow you to access your files anytime, anywhere. So sign up today for our 30-day free trial with no obligation. Go to ShareFile.com, click the microphone at the top of the homepage, and enter TechZilla. Remember, visit ShareFile.com and type in TechZilla.